Okay, why don't we get started? So thanks for coming. Hopefully you're having a fantastic WordCamp. So this session is going to cover effective conversion optimization techniques. And we all love conversions, right? It's what drives leads, it's what drives revenue, it drives growth. If you're part of an agency, it helps drive the business of your clients. So conversions are critical, right? They're the lifeblood of a company. Yet, if that's the case, why is it that for every $92 spent driving traffic to websites, marketers are only spending $1 converting that traffic? It's a little insane, isn't it? And so what we're going to look at today is really an opportunity for you to differentiate your business, your agency. It's a chance for you, if you have a maniacal focus on conversion optimization, driving as many conversions as possible, and your competition is not, it gives you a very good leg up. So who am I? So my name is Tom Shapiro. I'm the CEO of Strategy, which is a marketing, web design, and branding agency in the Boston area. I'm also the founder of a neuromarketing group in the Boston area. We have about 350 members now. If anyone is in the Boston area, we'd love for you to attend our events. They're all free, and we bring in speakers from local universities or authors or neurotech companies and have them demo their technology. So it's the Boston Neuromarketing Meetup for anyone who's in the area. As background, I've worked with many, many different types of companies through the years, everything from startups to middle market companies, as well as over a dozen Fortune 500 companies. And one of the things which I've found is there's a lack of focus on conversion optimization across the board. I don't care if you're at Kraft Foods and you have $50 billion in revenue, or whether you have 20 employees. For whatever reason, there tends to be a lack of focus on conversion optimization. So what we're going to do is go through in a very fast-paced manner today over 25 different ways that you can be driving your conversions growth. And honestly, if you do half a dozen of these, it's very realistic that you can double your conversion rate. And that's not an exaggeration. So where do we start? What we like to do is always start with the audience, and specifically audience segmentation. And so I'm kind of curious how many of you have defined, documented audience personas? Show of hands. Okay, so just a few. So I would start here, literally later today, tomorrow, start documenting exactly, precisely who your prospects are, who your ideal prospects are, in as much detail as possible. Not just demographics, but also psychographics. Look at different industries. Look at different roles within companies. If it's consumers, or, you know, what's the age group? Is it male or female? In as much detail as possible. Because if you don't know this, if you don't have documented audience personas, automatically your marketing is going to be weakened. Because you can't be as targeted, you can't be as focused as you could if they are well defined. And so an example of this would be the software company Domo. So Domo is a dashboarding software company, and right on their homepage, what do? They help you self-select how to experience their website, right? Are you the CEO? Are you in finance? Are you in business intelligence? Are you in operations? Are you in marketing? Are you in service? And you click through and you have a unique experience that's customized to what you're most interested in. There's a company called Eloqua, which was a lead nurturing software company, and it was a week away from bankruptcy. And the CEO, Mark Morgan, had to figure out what to do. And so what he did was he turned to audience segmentation. And what he did was he really looked to micro-target. And he micro-targeted in different verticals and turned things around right away and wound up selling the company for over $800 million. Remember, he was just a week away from bankruptcy. That's the power of audience segmentation and knowing exactly who your clients are, because every message can be customized for exactly what they need to hear, what's going to help them the most, and you can differentiate yourself from the competition the most. So we start off with audience segmentation and personas, and then we have to look at, okay, for each of these personas, what's in it for them? So you come to a website, and oftentimes what you find is the website is kind of marketing itself like an encyclopedia or like a dictionary. Okay, so this is a CRM software company, and I come to the website, and what does it say? It says OnContact CRM software, a powerful all-in-one CRM solution. Well, I know that you're a CRM solution. Why should I care? Why should I buy from you? How are you any different? What's in it for me? There's nothing here that explains why this CRM solution is any better than anyone else in the industry. And you compare that with a website like Kissmetrics, and right off the bat, they tell you exactly what's in it for you, why you should stick around, why you should click, why you should find out more. Get, keep, and grow more customers. Understand what people are doing on your website and products so you can deliver more of what's working. Try Kissmetrics. Beautiful. So once you're really focused on what's in it for them, then you really do need to clarify how you are different from others. So I love this example. So there are lots of fast food chains in the U.S., and a lot of them sell chicken. You can go to McDonald's, or you can go to Wendy's, or you can go to Burger King. You know, lots of different options. And so why in the world would you start another fast food chain that sells chicken sandwiches? Well, what the Organic Cook did was they became the first USDA-certified organic fast food chain. And it resonates through all of their messaging, all of their visuals, and all of their marketing. And it's a very clear indication as to how they are drawing the line as to how they're different from everyone else, and that can be very, very powerful. So when we're talking about conversion optimization, we're not just talking about A/B testing, we're not just talking about your CTA button. You have to be an awesome marketer first. If you're not an awesome marketer, if you're not conducting awesome marketing, then I don't care how much you're trying to A/B test, and I don't care what your CTA button says, you're gonna be limiting your potential. Okay, so what's a tactic that you can take once someone's on your site? How about urgency, driving urgency? And there are many different ways of doing this. But psychologically, if you drive urgency, you tend to increase conversions. Here's a countdown clock, right? It's a fantastic mechanism for forcing people to feel a sense of urgency and drive them towards action, right? Drive them towards taking an action now rather than bookmarking it, putting it off till later, checking out the competition. And you can do this across the board, whether you're talking about white papers or trials or anything like that. So another thing you want to do is look at how can your website perfectly align with what interests your audience personas the most. And so this is going to get into the realm of what are you talking about? What's your messaging? What's the content in your website? What's the experience on your website? And I want to tell you a story about Nexus Shampoo. So in a prior life, when I was at a different agency, Nexus Shampoo called up and said, hey, we really want you to provide us with an SEO proposal because we want to drive as much traffic to our website as possible. And so myself and two others at the agency started diving into the data and looking at, okay, well, you know, everyone washes their hair, everyone needs shampoo, but they were specifically targeting women. And women who were willing to spend $18 on a bottle of shampoo. And so, you can walk into a CVS or a Walgreens and there are plenty of options for $3 shampoo, $4 shampoo. Theirs cost $18. And their argument was, oh, well, it's worth it because of the ingredients. They felt that they had the best ingredients in the market. And so that's what they talked about. He went to their website and he learned all about the ingredients that went into their shampoo. The problem is that no one cared about the ingredients in the shampoo. So we looked at the search data, we looked at the social data, we looked at the sharing data, we looked at the content data, you know, how much content is being produced in magazines and newspapers, online, by blogs. And if you compare shampoo and conditioner shampoo ingredients and conditioner ingredients and those types of terms against hairstyles, you find that no one No one was searching for shampoo ingredients. No one was writing about shampoo ingredients. No one was sharing online on the Facebook page or on Twitter about shampoo ingredients. What were they all interested in? Hairstyles. They were interested in short hairstyles, bob hairstyles, French braids. They were interested in wedding hairstyles, prom hairstyles, hairstyles for teenagers. The list was endless. There were over 25 million searches a year related to hairstyles. And you compare that to ingredients, and there was, you know, it was night and day. And so what we went back to Nexus, where we said, look, you know, you should be focusing on hairstyles. Forget about ingredients. Focus on hairstyles, because that's what your audience cares about. That's, if you want to focus on a CTA button, fine, but this is what's going to get them fired up. This is what's going to keep them engaged. This is what's going to get them consuming your content. This is what's going to get them buying your shampoo. Talk about what they love to talk about, what they love to share about, what they love to write about, what they love to take photographs of. It's all hairstyles. The brand loved it. And not only did they change the website, but they also changed all of their marketing across the board. They changed their TV ads. They changed their magazine ads. They changed everything across the board to talk about hairstyles instead of ingredients. What do you think happened? A 10x improvement in every metric you can imagine. Whether you're talking about traffic, whether you're talking about conversions, whether you're talking about video views, no matter what it was across the board, 10x. So as we're talking about conversion optimization, all too often in our industry, that conversation, it becomes very narrow in focus, right? And it talks about A/B testing tools, and it talks about CTA buttons, which is all awesome, and we'll get to that. But if you're not talking about what drives your audience to action, if you're not giving them the experience that they want to experience, that they're going to thrive within, then you're going to automatically be limiting your potential for conversions. Okay, so let's say that you found your hairstyles for your brand, and you're connecting with your audience about what they're passionate about. Then once they're on your site, what you want to do is start getting feedback. And a fantastic way to do this, there are lots of different tools to do this. This specific example is a tool called Qualaroo. And you ask them a question exactly at the point of interest on your website while they're still on your site. Because think about it. Let's say you get thousands and thousands of visitors to your site. When are you going to ask them what they think, or whether they have questions, or why didn't you convert here? You can't ask them after the fact. Once they leave your site, they're lost, right? And sure, you can retarget them, but that's unilateral from you to them. It's not from them to you, right? And so what you want to do is get them interacting with you while they're still on your site. And so think of where you could introduce surveys, where you can introduce questions at exactly the point that you want them converting it, and ask them, if they're not finding what it is that they were seeking, why is that? What were you looking for? What is lacking here? And get direct feedback from them, because again, you're not going to get it from them after they leave your site. Yes, so the question is, was that a pop-up? And yes, that was a pop-up. And there's different software that can do this. Mouseflow, Qualaroo, Hotjar, many different options out there. And we'll go through a bunch of software options later in the session. So one of the things which I love to do in looking at conversion optimization is behavioral analysis. So, you know, you talk to a lot of companies, and what do? They love their Google Analytics data, right? They love it, and they talk about the Google Analytics data. The problem with that is that tells you at a very high level where people are going, but it doesn't tell you about the experience. And I'll give you an example. So we had one client where they were really proud about how many people visited this one page on their site. They said, this is so popular, people love it. Well, we did a behavioral analysis on it, and guess what? No one was taking the actions on that particular page that they wanted. Yes, it was driving a lot of traffic, and then the experience didn't meet their needs. And so they weren't clicking where the company wanted them to click. And so it's very important not to stop at Google Analytics or any type of web analytics, but to really look at, okay, what's the behavior of your users once they're on your site? So I'll give you an example. So this is our website, just a simple blog post, right? And so this is scroll mapping. So we want to see how far down the page someone is actually scrolling, right? And so at the top of the page is going to be red, which indicates the most eyeballs, and that's obvious because that's where you land. And then as you scroll down the page, you see a drop off. And then as you scroll further down the page, you see a further drop off. And you can see here, I'm not sure if you can read it, but the authenticity paragraph is where you have a very big drop off. And so you might think initially, I should cut off the blog posts here because, you know, a lot of people are dropping off at this point, or I should delete authenticity, right? They see authenticity, they drop off, people aren't interested in it, delete. But what we need to do, when you're looking at behavioral data, you need to cross-reference it. And we'll come back to this, but you need to cross-reference it because your insights might be completely different. So let's cross-reference it with click mapping, heat mapping, and hover mapping. So this is a very well-known heat map indicating that on the left you have an image where the baby is looking at you, right? It's looking off of the screen directly at the site visitor. And where is the site visitor's eyeballs? Well, they're looking right at the baby, right? And then the other image on the right is where the baby is looking at the copy on the page. And where do the site visitor's eyeballs go? To the copy on the page. Yes, still to the baby's face, but also to the copy on the page. And so what you can learn from this is it's the same message, right? It's the same basic marketing. The only difference is one where the baby is looking at you, one where the baby is looking at the actual thing that you're supposed to be looking at. And as you can see through the heat mapping data, it's more helpful to look at, to have an image where the baby is looking at what you want the site visitor to look at, and that will draw them in. So let's circle back to the authenticity example that we're just looking at in scroll mapping. And remember, a lot of people came to the authenticity paragraph and they dropped off the page, right? If you can see here, this is the authenticity paragraph on the page, and it's where some of the deepest engagement is happening on the page. And so if we initially just looked at the scroll map, we would think, oh, people aren't interested. But actually, what it is that the people who did take the time to scroll down were deeply interested. This presents you with a whole other set of questions, right? So maybe what it is we need to move the authenticity paragraph up the page, or we need to introduce, you know, something that's a little more visually capturing, right? A little bit more visually stunning to grab more people to understand, just to get them to scroll a little bit further, because we know that once they scroll, they love the content that's there. And so again, don't just rely on one set of data, whether it's Google Analytics data, whether it's scroll mapping. You want to cross-reference, because what happens is the end insights can be the exact opposite of what you initially thought, looking at only one data set. So how else might we look at behavioral data? Fantastic thing, but really, really useful to look at is session recordings. And again, a lot of these tools will do this, whether it's Mouseflow or Hotjar, or this is a tool called Concura. It's specifically for agencies. And you can see actual users going through your site. This is not in a lab. This is not beta testers. These are your actual users on your actual site, and you're seeing their actual session going through your pages. And you know, we like looking at it from different ways. Here's one way to dig into it, which is looking at the cursor mapping through a session. And so you can actually see the cursor of the user as they're going through your pages. And not only on one page, but from page to page to page. And it's fascinating. So in this case, this again was our blog. And typically what we found with our blog was users would, or site visitors would come, and it would be a very, very vertical path going down the page. And then they would go up the page, and then they would go down the page, and up the page, and down the page. Very vertical, right? And you can see here, the site visitor went berserk, right? They're all over the place. They're zigging and they're zagging and they're going in diagonal directions and they're going horizontally. And so we looked into this and what we found was, okay, well, it was because we added a video here. And then we said, that's really interesting because this deviates from all other behavior that we're seeing in the blog when it's text only. But when we add a video here, you know, the behavior becomes quite different. And so we looked at all of the videos throughout all of our blog posts, and it was similar. And so what we realized was even if the site visitor was not clicking on the video, even if they weren't viewing the video, we found more engagement like this whenever we had videos. So the lesson there is, oh, okay, well, even if they're not watching videos, I mean, sometimes people can't watch videos. Sometimes they're at work, right? Sometimes they're in a cafe, they forgot their headphones, whatever it is. And so by looking at, in different ways, session recordings, right, cursor mapping, we can derive different insights. It's kind of fun. You can even do this right now, as I'm talking, as you're listening. If you go to mouseflow.com/demo, it will enable you to run a quick test. It only takes 5-10 seconds. And just move your cursor around on the page, and then it will provide the recording back to you. And that's exactly what you'll get using this type of technology with your own website users. So I would strongly recommend that you not only use behavioral analysis tools and data, but that you use it in different ways and you slice it and dice it and cross-reference it. So another thing that's very, very useful with behavioral analysis is looking at form abandonment rates and you know where people are dropping off. And so this is an example from Hotjar where you know people came to the page, they filled out their name, they filled out their email, and then bam, they fell off the form, right? They abandoned the form. Why? It was when they started asking for their phone number. So very clear indication, right? Very straightforward. Get rid of the requirement to submit a telephone number and you'll increase your form submissions. Very easy. So another thing that we want to do is make sure that when you're looking at your data, you're filtering correctly. You're filtering in a way that's going to enhance your analysis and give you the best insights. So how many of you look at, for example, your web analytics regularly? Okay, so quite a number of you, right? How many of you target the United States as your target market? So you're not looking to sell in Europe, you're not looking to sell in Asia. Okay, and for you who target the US, when you look at your web analytics data, are you excluding all other countries from your data? Typically the answer is no. Typically the answer is, oh, we just look at our Google Analytics data, right? But you're gonna have very, very different insights if you segment according to your specific audience. And geography tends to be one of the most common ones where companies get it wrong and they're trying to derive insights from visitors from China or from Argentina, but they don't sell there. And they wouldn't sell there. And if you're an agency and your clients are all here in the States, you need to be segmenting out that type of data and only focusing on your US data. So what I would encourage you to do is really look at your filtering options. You know, this is Concura, but it applies just as much to Google Analytics or any other tool that you're using. When you're looking at your analytics, filter out what's not relevant. Otherwise, you can really dilute the data, it can cause you to come up with the wrong insights. Okay, so just in this case, one of the things that we like to do with Concur data is look at, for example, new visitors as opposed to all visitors. Why is that? Because a new visitor is going to have a very different experience through the site and a different time navigating through the site, learning through the site than someone who's been there 2 or 3 or 4 times, right? And so if we just aggregate all this data and we're looking at their behavior in aggregate, it's going to be very, very difficult to understand how the experience has to change for a first-time user. Okay, so let's talk about CTA buttons because they are so critical to conversions. Once we know that we're targeting the right people, right, and giving them the experience that they're going to love, and it's going to drive them to action. And we're looking at how they're behaving on the site, and we're optimizing accordingly. Then let's look at the specifics, right? What's on the page? How can we change what's on the page? So CTA buttons, you can change them many different ways, lots of different things to test. And everything that we're talking about here, please, test, test, test. I don't have any answers. No one has any of the answers. You're going to find the answers through testing. And so Warby Parker, very interestingly, has two different calls to action right as you land on the page, but they're not equally weighted, and I like that. So add to cart is clearly the priority for them. Try it home for free, the other option. But what's nice about this is that they are very, very specific, try it home for free, versus the add to cart. Now you can also, you don't have to be boring with your CTAs, you can have fun with it. So in this website for this town, welcome to Humboldt County, follow the magic. So you can have fun with it. With Instapage, I love this example. So guaranteed to increase your conversion rate, the most powerful landing page platform for marketing teams and agencies, build my page now. That's great. That all leads towards a very specific action, which Instapage wants you to take immediately. In the nonprofit sector, it's fantastic to test out many different ways to drive higher donations. Okay, so in this case, Charity Water is giving me the option to pay by credit card or to pay by PayPal. Right? And you can subscribe and pay on a monthly basis, or you can donate all at once. And so, again, you want to be testing and testing and testing, but sometimes what you find is by giving the site visitor more than just one option, you might be able to increase your conversions that way. Now with your CTA buttons, what you also want to test is color. And here's a case where time and time again at our agency, what we find is the best design does not always drive the most conversions. I'm going to say that again. The best design doesn't always drive the highest conversions. Why? Because oftentimes the best design, the CTA button is blending in with the rest of the page. And if you want people to take notice, if you want them to feel compelled to click on something, oftentimes what you need more than blending in is contrast, right? And so in this example by Pingdom, you know, green might not be the perfect design decision here, but from a conversion standpoint, it's a very good option to test. Why? Because it completely stands out. You can't miss it. Your eye goes right there immediately. And then this is another common, I wouldn't say mistake, but it's a common opportunity that we see lost on many companies. And this is, they feel like they need to present the CTA once, and that's it. However, you can kind of go nuts in this area. You can include the CTA button over and over and over. You can include different CTA messages on the page or the same exact one over and over and over. So this is Hotjar, where they have the same exact CTA, the same color, the same message, the same destination, four different times on the page. I would have argued they should have put it in the footer too. In our experience, that does increase conversions. Exit intent technology, so something like Opt-in Monster, fantastic for increasing conversion. So what this is site visitors on your site, and then they take the cursor and they're about to exit from the site, right? So the cursor goes outside of the window to take them to a different page, and you present them with a message. And I'm sure we've all been presented with this by now. But it's fantastic anytime, whether you're in a shopping cart, whether it's a page with a B2B form, whether it's in a blog, it really doesn't matter. As long as you have a compelling message to keep them on site, to get them engaged, to get them clicking, then it's worth testing. And so in this case, in this blog, where you go, like our posts, get notifications. Nice. In this case, it's an e-commerce example where someone had added items to the actual cart but then left the site. And before they exit, you're going to hit them with save your basket to an email. Brilliant, right? So they're not asking you to actually purchase right now. They're not forcing you to make that choice. Do I purchase now or not? They're saying, hey, we'll email your basket to you. You can complete the transaction later. Fantastic idea to test. You can also try behaviorally based calls to action. So this is a case in our own blog where, I don't know if you've ever had this experience, where you go to a blog and you start reading it, and right off the bat they hit you with a pop-up, and they want you to subscribe, they want you to download a white paper, whatever it is. How do I know? I haven't even read anything yet. I hate that. And so what we do is we have it on time delay where only if you have proven that you like the content on the page will we present this to you. So if you go more than 60% down the page, then we'll present this to you. If you do not, we're not going to waste your time, right? We want to be hyper-targeted so that we're presenting this message at the exact right time to the exact right people. Okay, related content CTA. So this is one thing that HubSpot does really, really well, which I love. So this is an article that I wrote last year, okay, so in 2016, how emotion detection technology will change marketing. So very futuristic in scope, in spirit, right? So this is my article on their blog. And you scroll down the page on their blog, and what is their CTA message? The future of marketing, what 2017 will look like. Perfect, right? I wrote an article about the future, their CTA, to funnel into their conversion funnel, right? It was all about the future. They tie the topic into their CTAs very effectively. Cross-selling, another example. So you always want to be considering, well, if someone's interested in this, what else could they be purchasing from you? How else can you help them? How else can you add value? And so in this case, this is a store where you can order a meal that's delivered to you. So dynamic. So I go into the shopping cart dynamic and I say, yes, I want this specific meal delivered to me. And what do they do? Right in the shopping cart itself, right then and there, they present me with additional options, related options of what I would probably like and should add to the cart. Site speed. So site speed is fantastic for many reasons. Google applied for a patent back in 2010. It was awarded in 2014, which clearly indicates that site speed is part of Google's algorithm. So that alone should indicate that you should be paying attention to it. And also more directly related to conversions, you know, you can look at countless studies, countless examples where site speed is critical for driving conversions. Amazon has publicly stated that for every 1 second that they add in page load time, they lose $1.6 billion in revenue. Radware ran a study where among the companies that they studied, for every 2 seconds in page load time that they reduced, conversions doubled. Doubled. So page speed matters. And if you're looking for tools to test it, WP Engine has a fantastic speed test, Pingdom has a great one, and Google has a few as well. Also, evoke emotions. So this is getting into more of the neuromarketing side of things. So the neuroscientist Antonio Damasio ran studies of people who had damage to the part of the brain that triggers emotions. So these people could not feel emotions. And what he found was they couldn't make purchase decisions. So in other words, without emotions, if your website is not evoking an emotional response out of your site visitors, you're making it mentally and physically difficult for them to convert, okay? So let's look at an actual example of this. Let's say you're a co-working space. Here's a co-working space in Dallas, co-working office space in Dallas. Does that evoke an emotional response? No. What does WeWork do instead? Workspace for escaping the grind. Look forward to your commute with spaces designed for fresh ideas, organic networking, and month-to-month flexibility. So always be driving emotions. Make it visual. So the human brain is wired to process visuals. In fact, it processes visual 60,000 times faster than text. And just to prove this, there's a neuroscientific study done of 54 of the best wine tasters in the world in Bordeaux, France. And what they did was they added odorless red dye to white wine. And so it really was white wine, but it looked red. And they asked them to describe wine. There's different vocabulary for describing red wine versus white wine. So out of 54 of the best wine tasters in the world, how many do you think got it right and saw past the red color and described the wine as white wine? Do you think 50% got it right? Show of hands. Okay, how about 25% got it right? 10%? Okay, how about 1%? Nope, zero. No one got it right. That's the power of vision. Mirror neurons. So there's a scientific team in Parma, Italy, years ago that was looking at monkeys' brains and what triggered their neurons. And one day, a scientist walked in with an ice cream cone and started licking it, and the monkey's brains went nuts. And okay, so the monkey might be hungry or something like that, but what they found, what was really interesting was, they found that those specific neurons that were being triggered were the exact same neurons as if the monkey was eating the ice cream itself. And so this is very, very powerful in marketing. Show them what they want to be, right? Show them why they should buy your product, why they should buy your service to get to their aspirational self or the aspirational end goal of their company. We're running out of time, so I'll just quickly go through this. Social proof is very, very powerful. What I'll say here is the more specific you can be, the better. For Basecamp, they go as far as to say, just last week, 5,776 companies signed up for Basecamp. Be as specific as possible. Online chat. So Jerome's Furniture added chat into the actual sales process. So once someone was ready to buy, online chat was added, not to a call center, but to the actual store, and they were talking to actual employees. So the employees could walk over to the actual piece themselves, take photos of it, take videos of it, take photos of other furniture, and have a real dialogue with them. What did that do? It increased conversions by 10 times over. 10 times. And so, here, I'll jump ahead to A/B testing. So obviously, you want to be A/B testing. There was a session earlier today all about testing, right? You want to be A/B testing everything, whether it's your message, whether it's colors, whether it's your design, whether it's your offer, whether it's your CTAs, whether it's videos versus images, everything, everything, everything. I'm going to make my deck available to you, and it lists a number of fantastic technologies that you can use for everything from A/B testing to behavioral analytics, to the online surveys. So these are more on the behavioral analytics side, and then these are more of the landing page builders and A/B tests. And one last thing I'll leave you with is, so I just published a book, the Kindle version is on Amazon. If you'd like to download the first chapter, just go to rethinkyourmarketing.com/WC Boston. And you're gonna have the first chapter for free. It's a book that describes a lot of what we just went through. Rethinking how to be exceptional at your marketing. If you're stuck, if you're running test after test after test, and you're running around in circles and you're treading water, this will help you get unstuck and unleash revenue growth. So that's it. Do we have time for any questions?
Great. Did you want to find you after that?
Okay. Yeah.
I mean, really, we got less than 1 minute to go. So good job, Tom.
If anyone does have any questions, I'll stay up here for as long as you need, and I can also go to the happiness bar afterwards and talk to you further.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you. So.